Welcome to Class 5, Loading and Performance for the Warren County Community College Small Unmanned System Drone Program Part 107 Prep Course, otherwise known as UAS 105. In this video, and there's only one this time, we're going to talk about drones and aviation. We'll talk about how do you determine speed and altitude. We'll talk about the rules in Part 107 about loading. We'll talk about load factors, we'll talk about aircraft performance, and we will talk about stalls and critical angle of attack, which I highly suggest you also watch the other videos that we provided to you, especially for critical angle of attack and stalls, as these can be confusing subjects. So the first thing you have to kind of realize with Part 107 is who is responsible. This is probably a question you're going to see a lot on your Part 107 test, and you should 99% of the time get a gleeful smile on your face, because the answer is almost always remote pilot in command. Who's responsible? Remote pilot in command. Something went wrong. Who's responsible? Remote pilot in command. Who's responsible for ensuring remote pilot in command? It's almost always the answer. So this is a little bit of a help with kind of the test questions. If you see the words, who's responsible, you can pretty much almost always pick the remote pilot in command. But you still should take your time with the test and read all the test questions. Okay, so what are you responsible for? Well, this also involves checking for the proper loading of your small unmanned aircraft system. Prior to each flight, you must check proper loading. Is it loaded correctly? The center of gravity, that's what CG stands for, the center of gravity, and that no flight characteristics are adversely affected by cargo. Now, if you're flying a drone like the unique Typhoon down here, you know, this is perfectly designed by the company with the camera for the center of gravity. The legs come up and down. I mean, this is going to fly. Now, if you start to tie things to this or try to, you know, I guess put a third party aftermarket device on here to carry something, you're going to affect that loading and that proper center of gravity. So you need to be aware of that, because you are responsible as the remote pilot in command. And you can see this with all basically drones or unmanned aircraft. We can look at the Predator drone up here, and you can see that it is designed to be aerodynamic, and it is designed to have a proper center of gravity. And even later, when the U.S. military weaponized these drones, they had to make sure the center of gravity remained intact. So why are you so responsible? So let me try to switch here. The reason is something called the FAA's airworthiness certification standards. So you're going to want to be aware that these exist. So we'll go ahead and try to switch screens here real quick and go to the FAA screen. So you'll see, if you go to the FAA, and you can just Google FAA airworthiness certification and come to this page, and it'll tell you how the FAA certify aircraft. It'll tell you about the overview, the process, the standard certificate, the special certificates, design approvals, international approvals, production approvals. And if you go through this, it's a rather complicated process, very expensive. And it makes sense for, you know, large aircraft, manned aircraft, but it may not make sense for a $400 drone, a $400 small unmanned aircraft system commercial off the shelf. So kind of the way that the FAA got around this was, since they can't certify all these drones, and remember, a lot of people make and build their own drones from independent third party. They'll buy the components and they'll build their drone. And if you were to get our degree, you would learn how to do this from, you know, basically a shell and components. You would put together the drone from start to finish. Well, there's no way for the FAA to certify that aircraft. So they had to come up with another method. And that method is by putting elements into Part 107 and making you responsible as the remote pilot in command. So one of the other things you'll see in the Part 107 material is the instructions to always check manufacturer recommendations for evaluating safe and efficient operation. check that all objects carried, including the manufacturer-installed camera, are secure. So this is, again, what we will go over in live flight training, but we'll provide you with an initial checklist, and you may modify that as time goes on, but you should have a checklist. Redundancy is an important safety consideration, and that's why the FAA is going to tell you, if you're the remote pilot in command, that it's you're responsible, and you're the one that they're going to look to make sure these things are done. And checklists are very important to kind of keep this redundancy, keep this uniformity in what you're checking. But you cannot have a checklist that violates manufacturer's recommendations or guidance. So if the manufacturer says not to do something and you do, you're responsible. So that's kind of what the FAA is always going to say. Go back to the manufacturer, the manual that came. Often those are online now. And sometimes you may never even be able to find one. Another thing you need to know for your Part 107 is aircraft flight controls. So in our test prep book, it's usually figure 4-1. You need to recognize this, and you kind of need to memorize it in your test prep guide. I put a slightly varied copy of the image here on the screen so that you know what an aileron, an elevator stabilator, and a rudder do. So when we're talking about an airplane's movement, Let's talk about the chart here. They're trying to give you a sense of this. Now, this will be a little bit different in a quadcopter. What we call a yaw, a pitch, and a roll might be slightly different than we'll go over those in the live flight training classes. But for the test, you need to become familiar with this. So you need to understand there's primary control surface. There's the aileron, there's the elevator stabilator, and there's the rudder. You need to understand that the aileron affects the roll, and you can see it here, the side to side kind of roll, and you see by this blue arrow what they mean by that. So that you would put the right wing down, left wing down. The elevator stabilator controls the pitch, and you can see that here in the orange, and so that's the nose up or the tail up, nose down. This is really important when you're landing a manned aircraft. As you're coming closer to the ground, you couldn't land a plane without these controls. And then you need to understand the rudder, and the rudder will control the yaw. So they'll also tell you the axis, whether it's longitudinal or lateral, and the type of stability. But really, it's these first two that are on the test now. The name of the control, aileron, elevator, stabilator, and rudder, and what it does to an airplane. Does it roll the airplane, which is your blue angling here? Does it pitch your aircraft, nose up, tail down, nose down? Or does it yaw, which is basically moving left to right, as we would think of it if we were driving a car? So let's take a little bit of a look in case you're not familiar. The aileron is a hinged surface in the trailing edge of an airplane wing used to control the lateral balance. So it's right about right there. The elevator stabilator, and there's the elevators, there's the stabilator, and there's also the tail wing also is a stabilizer, and the rudder you can see is there it depicted as well. So this is known in aircraft terminology as all moving tailplane, all movable tailplane, all moving stabilizer, all flying tailplane, full flying stabilizer, flying tail, and slab tailplane. What you need to remember for your test, though, is that controls the pitch. Now, the rudder, and we have that here depicted on your screen, is a vertical airfoil pivoted from the horizontal stabilizer. Right here is the stabilizer for controlling movement around the vertical axis, controls the yaw, which is really turning left, turning right while you're in the sky. Not turning like a car, but it sets the direction. There's a question you might get. What purpose does a rudder perform or control on an SUAS airplane? Now, remember, it's different on a quadcopter, but the rudder controls the yaw, which is, again, why I said you kind of have to just memorize that. And you have your little picture there in your book, and you have your picture in this video to help you. So the other thing you have, you're responsible for ultimately, is determining the speed and altitude. So if you're building your own drone with your own remote control, you may not have a speedometer built in it. Most commercial off-the-shelf drones now will have that. Most of them commercial off-the-shelf, unless you're really talking about some racing drones. They're probably controlled, so you're never going to get close to this. But know this. The rule is you cannot fly faster than 87 knots, which is the equivalent of 100 miles per hour. They will interchange these. So like on test questions, what they like to do is they like to say, how fast, what's the maximum speed you can go? And they'll be 87 mile per hour, 87 knots, 100 knots. And so you have to kind of figure this out. So it's important that you kind of memorize your speed cannot go past 100 miles per hour. That's usually pretty easy for people, especially people new to aviation. It's the 87 knots that's often difficult. You have to memorize that again. Remember, you cannot fly above 400 feet of the ground unless you're flying within 400 feet radius and 400 feet above a structure's uppermost limit. Then you can go above. So if you're doing a cell tower that's 900 feet, you would technically above the ground be able to go 1,300 feet in the air. At that point, you're in Class E airspace. Don't forget that. For the most part, there's probably almost very few places where you wouldn't be. And then once you're up in that kind of at that you would need air traffic control permission. So remember 1200 or 700 feet, usually is your uppermost limits anyway. So let's say you couldn't figure out your speed, and there was no speedometer in your drone. And probably that won't be the case unless you're building your own, and you're probably going to build them in anyway. You can use a process known as dead reckoning. And this is the process of calculating one's current position by using a previously determined position or fix and advancing that position based upon known or estimated speeds over elapsed time and course. Now, it's important to kind of realize this is a very, very difficult thing to do. But this is the answer on the test. If you have to determine your speed and you don't have the equipment and the sensors within the drone to do that for you, then you would use a process called dead reckoning. This takes tremendous amount of practice and understanding of math and the ability to calculate things quickly. So can it be done? Yes. Can most people do it? Probably not after just reading the book or watching this video, but that is the process that you would use to stay within those speed limits. All right. So in addition to, you're always responsible for how fast your drone's going, you're also responsible for all loading. So every piece of mounted equipment should be balanced in a manner that does not adversely affect the center of gravity or result in unsafe performance. So, you know, if you were to tie a brick onto one of those wings, let's say this wing over here, with a string, or you'd probably need something stronger than a string, you've affected the center of gravity. You might get off the ground, but you are flying in an unsafe condition. So you're violating the rules, basically. So remember, you're responsible for whatever you load on this drone, but you're also responsible for making sure whatever is loaded on the drone by the manufacturer is in good working order. So if the camera flies off and hits someone, who's responsible? The remote pilot in command. So before every flight, you need to verify that the unmanned aircraft is correctly loaded by determining the weight and balance condition. So again, if you haven't put any third-party components on your drone or built any with 3D printing, and it's a commercial off-the-shelf drone, and you've checked that all the components that the manufacturer put on there are in good working order and are secured, then you're probably in good shape. You probably don't have too much to worry about, but again, we'll come back to that idea of checklists. Review the manufacturer's weight and balance data and be certain to follow all restrictions and limitations. So you may not be able to find that readily, but if you are doing that kind of complicated modifying the aircraft, then I suggest you really do need some more educational courses beyond just passing your pencil and paper Part 107 test for your own sake. So when we talk about computing weight and balance, the most common performance deficiencies of an overloaded aircraft are. And again, this is what you might get on a test. You might need to know one, more, or all of these. So know this, if you've overloaded an aircraft, you're going to have a reduced rate of climb. This should make common sense. If, let's say for example, we put a 3-pound weight on the bottom of the drone and we maintain the center of gravity. It's not going to be able to reach altitudes as fast as without that weight. It was designed by the manufacturer most of the time for the aircraft that they provide you. So if you start to, you know, modify it, you are likely going to reduce the rate of climb because you probably won't have the engine power that you need. You may have a lower maximum altitude. This also makes sense, because you may not be able to get as high as you can with the drone when it's designed by the manufacturer. Shorter endurance, this makes perfect sense. If you've loaded the drone and the drone's battery life is normally 30 minutes, but now it's a lot heavier, the propellers are going to have to spin a lot more. And so that's going to make your battery life, and that's what they mean by shorter endurance. When they say endurance, they're talking really, for most quadcopters, about the lithium battery life. And you're going to have reduced maneuverability. This also makes sense. If you're out there with your drone and it's a calm day and you can kind of zip, 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 zip around with it, having a good time. If all of a sudden you put something else on there that's heavy, and here at the Warren County Community College, we have modified some drones so that we can, I'll be very honest, mostly for PR purposes, you know, people like to see water balloons dropped or something of that nature, kind of shows what drones are capable of. And, you know, we have one where we would show package delivery, but that's always shorter endurance. But it's also reduced maneuverability. So the aerodynamics matter. This is why when Amazon talks about package delivery, they're really talking about maximum of an 8-pound package at this point that they would expect to deliver. So, you know, you're not going to see living room couches flying around the national airspace anytime soon. So you should also know that excessive weight reduces flight performance in almost every respect. Shorter endurance. In other words, you're going to burn through that battery fast. Operating above the maximum weight limitation can compromise the structural integrity of an unmanned aircraft. Well, let's look again at our friend here, the Unique Typhoon. You know, you got mostly plastic, maybe some carbon fiber. You know, that's not a lot of structural integrity. It's not made out of steel. You know, so a lot of these commercial off the shelf drones are plastic. So you start adding too much to the aircraft, you are going to mess with the structural integrity. So you need to remember that as well. And who's responsible? Well, you are. Well, at least you will be once you have that pilot's license you're studying for. It is the responsibility of the remote pilot in command to use the most current weight and balance data when planning the flight and operating this small unmanned aircraft system. Loading the aircraft outside those limitations, and limitations we mean weight, balance, or both, may lead to moments that exceed the capabilities or capacity of the flight controls or engines, thus leading to loss of control or another performance issue. So, you know, you could burn out your little motor here. On the Unique, you're good. If you burn out one motor, it still stays in the air. On something like a DJI Phantom, you only have four. So at that point, when you only have four, if you burn out one, it comes to the ground rather quickly. So just bear in mind that it's easy to lose control and really do something foolish. So don't do that. Operation with the center of gravity outside the approved limits results in difficulty controlling the small unmanned aircraft system. So let's think about this Predator for a second. If we put some kind of weaponized missile on one side, but not on the other, that's not going to, you know, it's now out of balance. It's not going to fly, and it's going to be difficult to control. So that's why there would be, you know, missiles on both sides, and hopefully that will work. You know, the military has looked at this extensively, but you remember they went from the Predator to the Reaper, and they had to build them larger as they began to go from surveillance vehicles to weaponized vehicles. And remember, an S, a small unmanned aircraft system loaded with a rearward center of gravity is less stable at all speeds. So, you know, that for a quadcopter or a hexacopter, that may not make as much sense. But when we get up here into this area, into the Predator, you know, if we all of a sudden there was a lot of weight in the back, that would change the aerodynamics as well. So the FAA is going to tell you that a useful load includes the power source, which is the battery, and the payload, okay, which in your case, my case, remember, it's illegal to weaponize any kind of aircraft unless you're the military. So don't put fire, don't put flamethrowers on them. You know, don't put weapons on them. You can Google. Do not do these things because you're not legally allowed to do it. All right. So your payload is almost always going to be a camera of some kind. Okay. So useful load includes that battery, the payload, mission equipment, which with drones is most often a camera. Now, also remember, you can't carry an extra battery on the drone. The only lithium battery allowed on one of these drones is the one providing the power source. That is a test question that you may get. Remember it. And let's talk a little bit about load factor. And here we're going to talk about those G forces. And you're going to have this figure. It's going to be in your supplement. You're going to see this figure a lot of places while you're taking your test. It's people look at this and at first sight, this looks like it's going to be hard. This is in fact among the easiest questions, I think. And remember, you're taking an electronic test at an FAA testing site. And within that computer system will be a small, easy to use calculator. I also believe you're allowed to bring an aviation based calculator. But they have one, and I've been in two different testing sites, one for my initial, one for my recurrent, and not always the same. So the loads imposed on the wings or rotors in flight are stated as load factor. Okay. This load factor is stated in terms of 1G. All right, so G-force, you've heard this term in movies, where G refers to the pull of gravity. So you've heard pilots, you've heard, you know, you've seen it in movies. You may have once had someone who had been an Air Force pilot or Navy pilot or Marine pilot come and say something, and they talk about the G-force and how many Gs and et cetera. This is basically what we're looking at here. It has a lot to do with the angle bank of the aircraft, and then how does it increase that gravity or that load? So if you've ever ridden a roller coaster, you're familiar with this. As you go around turns, you feel like you're sucked into the seat of a roller coaster. Same kind of concept. So what kind of question's going to be on the test? Well, not a particularly difficult one, as I said. Unmanned aircraft performance can be decreased due to an increase in load factor when the aircraft is operated in maneuvers other than straight and level flight. So when we talk about when you get a question that's talking about maximum performance, maximum endurance, anything along this, the answer is always, how do you get the maximum endurance? Straight and level flight. So the second you start to turn, and that'll be a question, what will reduce endurance or performance? You're going to turn, and that's what we're talking about here, and you can kind of see this red line turning here. So remember, your answer is either probably going to be in these kind of questions, which are just words and you're not doing any of the math, straight and level flight or turns. You need to also remember that at high speeds, the capacity of flight controls or a strong gust of wind may increase the load factor beyond safe limits. A change in speed during a straight flight will not produce any appreciable change in load, but when a change is made in the drone flight path, i.e. a turn, an additional load is imposed upon the structure. This is particularly true if a change in direction is made at high speeds with rapid forceful control movements. So let's give an example of the type of question you might find on a test. So if it says something like a small unmanned aircraft system weighs 20 pounds, what approximate weight would the small unmanned aircraft system structure be required to support during a 60 degree bank turn while maintaining the same altitude? Okay, it's a lot here. Don't look over here in this graph. All you need to do is look here and at this N, the load factor N. All right, so the first thing you need to do is, okay, 60 degrees. These little circles here represent degrees. So we go to 60, and then you see It's double. The load factor is double. So at this case, if it's 20 pounds, 60 degree turn, you take 2 and times it 20. So the answer would be 40 pounds. If you, and this isn't a, I've changed the numbers a little bit, but you're going to get questions like this on the test. Be aware that they won't always come out in whole numbers. You've also often get a decimal place. There's no decimal place answers, so you're going to need to round up or round down and use the proper rounding techniques that you learn in grade school. Another example, so let's say it's 30 pounds with a 0 degree turn. You're going to go to here to angle of bank, 0 degrees. That's 1. 1 times 30 is 30. So I've used 2 really simple examples, but you get the idea. That's all you have to do is that simple mathematical equation. And I love when you get a test question like this. You can go to the figure. You can plug in the numbers. They're going to put a lot of verbiage up here. Don't worry about anything. You're looking for the degree, the weight, and it's the load factor of the degree identified times the weight of the aircraft, and you're going to get the right answer. Okay, so again, we're going to give you several videos. We're going to in your syllabus for this, but stalls are something you have to be aware of. I've taken liberty of just putting a drone picture on here that I found off the internet rather than an airplane, and just to give you an idea. So remember, there's a horizon plane that'll be referenced. That's right here, the horizon. There's an angle of attack between the relative wind and the chord line, or that imaginary line through the middle of the aircraft. All right. And you get a sense of the horizon versus the Earth's surface here. This would be a rather, obviously not to scale. All right. So remember, with manned aircraft, the unmanned aircraft will stall when the critical angle of attack of the wings, rotors, propellers is exceeded. So if you were to exceed this angle of attack between the relative wind and the chord line, you will stall this aircraft. At slow speeds, the maximum available lifting force of the wing is only slightly greater than the amount necessary to support the weight of small unmanned aircraft system. So speeds will be an issue as well, and you'll want to kind of work your test prep questions to see. Here's an idea. When operating an unmanned aircraft, the remote pilot in command should consider that the load factor on the wings or rotors may be increased anytime the aircraft is subjected to maneuvers other than straight and level flight. So that's an example of a kind of question you might see on your test. Which basic flight maneuver increases the load factor on a small unmanned aircraft as compared to straight and level flight? And we said, if you're not going straight and level, then you're turning. So turns would be an answer. And again, you'll find these questions in your test prep book as well, and on your electronic practice tests. Stalls. An airfoil is a structure or body that produces a useful reaction to air movement. The angle of attack is the angle between the chord line of the airfoil and the relative wind. So chord line, relative wind. There's where you can have stalls. So let's take another look. Slow speed, you'll see your angle of attack. Okay, so you have your relative wind, you have your chord line, a little bit bigger. Cruise speed, relative wind, angle of attack shrinks. High speed, angle of attack becomes smaller. Okay, as the angle of attack is increased, to increase lift, the air will no longer flow smoothly over the upper airfoil surface, but instead will become turbulent near the trailing edge. The angle of attack at which a stall occurs is called the critical angle of attack. So if you've gone beyond the angle of attack based on your speed, know that when you're coming to the angle at which a stall will occur, it's called the critical angle of attack. And the angle of attack is the acute angle, this is the definition, between the relative wind and the chord line of the wind. So remember, acute angles are these that occur here between the 90 degree mark. Okay, it means it's sharp, is an angle smaller than a right angle, thus it is less than 90 degrees, which is why your load factor only has so many elements. In aeronautics, A chord is the imaginary straight line joining the leading and trailing edges of an airfoil. So you can kind of see it there in your picture. The chord length is the distance between the trailing edge and the point of the leading edge where the chord intersects the leading edge. So let's also go back and just think about angle of attack. When the angle of attack is increased to between 18 degrees and 20 degrees, which might be the critical angle of attack on most airfoils, the airstream can no longer follow the upper curvature of the wing because of this excessive change in direction. Airfoil will stall, and that's the critical angle of attack has been exceeded. The airspeed at which the stall occurs will be determined by the weight and load factor. The stall angle of attack is the same. So you kind of have to familiarize yourself with this. You're going to want to watch a number of videos on angle of attack, especially if you're new to aviation. It can be a little bit of a difficult concept to understand. There aren't that many questions on the test related to it. So if you work the test prep book, you're going to know probably the answers. They don't change the answers on the Part 107 too often. But here's an example. The angle of attack at which an airfoil stalls will what? Remain the same regardless of gross weight. So speed is an impact, but the gross weight is not. An increase in the load factor will cause an unmanned aircraft to what? Stall at a higher speed. An increase in load factor will cause an unmanned aircraft to stall at a higher airspeed. Because remember, it's shrinking that angle of attack. Let's talk a little bit about performance, a little bit easier here in this section. Even when specific performance data is unavailable, the remote pilot of command should be aware of. So even if you don't have performance data, you're still responsible, remember? So you have to be aware of your operating environment. So that's why we always tell you, go out and check everything in advance before you fly any mission. You must be aware of all available information regarding the safe and recommended operation of the SUAS. So there's no air certification done by the FAA or through the federal government. You have to read the manual and be aware. So after you've watched the videos and figured that out, make sure you go back and look at some of your, as you become more familiar with these, as you go through all the courses, you know, become familiar with your aircraft. Conditions that may impact the performance and or controllability of the SUAS. So it could be wind, it could be weather, it could be ground conditions, it could be all kinds of things, but it can also be load factors, what you do to the aircraft, any of these things. You are ultimately responsible. Also, if you're going upslope, that will contribute a deterring force component, increasing the launch distance required. So think of it like this. If you have a runway, if you're trying to take off with a runway that's on an angle and you're going uphill or upslope, that's going to take you longer to take off because there's going to be a deterring force the way your plane is angled at takeoff. Downslope, the opposite, contributes to an accelerating force. So you may need less runway to take off. So this is why some, depending on the angle of runways, they may be longer or shorter. And pilots, especially manned pilots, because think about it, they're in the aircraft. So if, you know, it's not like they're going to crash the drone and then have to fix it or buy another one. You know, when the plane crashes, it's quite, you know, that's catastrophic. So, you know, they need to be more aware of this, but you need to understand it too, because your license not only covers quadcopters, which most people fly as drones, but also fixed wing aircraft as well. So you need to be aware of these things and you need to be aware of the performance issues. The most critical conditions of launch performance are the result of some combination of, and you want to memorize these. What are the most critical conditions of launch performance? The gross weight of the aircraft, the altitude, temperature, and unfavorable wind. So if you've overloaded the drone or the drone's too heavy, that's going to affect performance. As you go up in the air, and we talked about this with density altitude, and the air thins, that's going to affect performance. Temperature will affect density altitude as well. So as the temperature becomes hotter, you may see a thinning of the air, and that will affect your performance. And of course, unfavorable wind, heavy, high winds will affect your performance. They're going to use up more, all these things are going to use up more battery life. So if you think, oh, I've flown this drone for 10 times now and I always get 28 minutes. Well, if all of a sudden you're going higher, for some reason you put a third party aftermarket device on there, it's really hot and it's a windy day, you're not going to get the same endurance, the same performance out of the aircraft. The maximum endurance condition is obtained at the point of maximum power required, since this requires the lowest fuel flow or battery to keep the SUAS steady. Straight, level, no wind, moderately temperature day. That's when you're going to get your beautiful high time in the air. In other words, your battery's going to last longer. Maximum endurance, hence, is obtained at the point of minimum power to maintain the aircraft in steady level flight. And that, again, will be a test question, so you'll want to be aware of that. Steady level, and you know the other conditions. So you might get a question something similar to this. According to 14 CFR Part 1, who is responsible? I don't even have to read anymore. Who's responsible? The remote pilot in command, because that's who's always responsible. There you go. So you know what to grab on that question. What is the best source for performance data? It's not the FAA. They don't certify for airworthiness these small unmanned aircraft. So the best source of information is manufacturer publications. So when you get these kinds of questions, you'll be familiar with that. I'm Dr. Will Austin. This has been Class 5 on Loading and Performance. We'll see you soon back in class. Take care.